Hi guys, Heather here at the Kraaft Shaak, and I am bringing you a fun little project using these ID badges, a used piece of trash, my Jell-O box, a couple of these book binding rings. I got a couple of sizes. I wasn't exactly sure how it was going to work. It's going to depend on that edge, but in the end, I used the larger ones. So the first thing you want to do, obviously, is cut up your box. I'm just showing you there that it's the perfect size for these little ID badges, great little pockets to put like ATC sized images into it. So if you're an ATC collector, which is an artist trading card, if you're a collector of those, this would be a great project for those. You can also use those nine pocket, they're all the rage right now with pocket letters and whatnot, the nine pocket like baseball trading plastic sleeves and stuff, but this is a great size that you could actually use in your purse. And I'm going to use this particular album when I'm done as my grandma's brag book and put pictures of the grandbabies in there. So of course I wanted to be something pretty, so in order to do that you first have to open up the box so that it will be a flat cover, and then I'm gluing down those edges. That will help make it a little bit more sturdy. But then, as you can see on the right and left side there, there's like a small flap there from the cutting it in half, that little extra flap on the ends. And I'll show you how we fix that in a little bit. So make sure that's all stuck down real good. I use that my favorite glue, that Tombow glue. It just works really quick and dries pretty quick. So, and there I'm trying to figure out exactly how I want to do this, and I know for sure that it will fit the way that I have it. It's exactly the right height. I might have wanted it to be a little bit bigger, but this is perfect for me. I like this. And there I'm showing you there's no way to punch those holes with just a regular hole punch, and I do not have a crocodile or you know, Big Bite or any of those kind of devices that would punch holes for me in cardboard. So I'm going to do this the old-fashioned way, and we'll get to that in a second. So first, the first thing that I decided I wanted to do was score the spine so that it would bend, you know, in a round fashion. And in order to do that, I pulled out the scoreboard, and then there's one section where the two flaps are glued together by the factory, and that was really hard to score that. And you'll see here, it is very hard to fold it too, but I do it. I managed to do it. Now, if you're going to do this yourself, don't do what I did and forget to glue where the factory glued, because I did. I forgot to do that, and in the very end it starts to come apart a little bit. I catch it, I glue it, it's fine, but be smarter than me. Take that apart, re-glue it so that it's done the way you want it to be. So here you see me using the X-Acto blade to pierce like an X into each of those holes, and then I go in with my scissors and round it out. I hate this. This is not the way that I wanted to do it, but I could not find any tool that would do it better. Invest in a Big Bite chomper thing. That's, see, seriously, just invest in the Big Bite already. Yeah, that's on my list. I'll get one someday. So anyway, I skipped me fooling around with them too much and just go straight into gesso heavy. So I'm going to use the white heavy gesso from Finnebear's line, her Art Basics line by Prima. And even with it being heavy gesso, I am still going to need three coats front and back. And so I do chop out a lot of that video because it's really just what you're seeing right now a few times. So now this is the key though. After every single coat, both on the front and on the back, I go in and clear out the gesso out of the holes. Seriously, just get a Big Bite already. But anyway, okay. So now this is the first coat on the inside. And I did a pretty good layer. I mean, I don't want it to take forever to dry, but definitely want to make sure that those edges get covered, and trying to hide the Jell-O part of the box. And then there's a lot of let it dry. Oh yeah, and don't forget to clean out the holes. So we do this a couple of times. So second layer. Inside. Clean out the holes. Now, if you're looking for a supply list on everything that I used here in this project, you can find that on the blog, and there should be somewhere up there in the right-hand corner is an information card, which will link directly to it. Or, of course, the links are down below for you to get to the various places that I used, items that I used in this project. So what I really wanted was, I don't know if you guys are familiar with CC in Canada. She's an excellent artist. She does some great YouTube videos. I just love her. I love her personality. She inspires a lot of what I do. And she has recently done a journal cover. And I will put a link to her channel so you can go check it out. But if you aren't familiar with her, I should say, I'm pretty sure everybody who watches me watches her because she's just that good. It just makes sense, right? Anyway, she did a journal cover, and she used like teal, turquoise blue, and white, and made this really pretty cover. And I thought, ooh, I like those colors. And I really wanted to use the neon paints that I just purchased and see what they were going to be like. And I thought, if I made a turquoisey blue background like she did, or similar to what she did, then I would be able to use those paints. And so that was my goal here. I wasn't really trying to achieve anything other than to make it have some of that Dyna paint. I love those PBOs and that iridescence of that Dyna paints. But then at some point, you see me adding the white stripes here going up and down vertically in on the cover. And I eventually mess with that, but I must have done it off camera, because you'll see when it comes back that it looks a little bit different than that. It's quite a bit lighter, but I added more white. So now using the Neo colors, Neo Color 2, because they are water soluble, I am going to create what I was attempting to create was marble, like green and blue marble. That was my idea. I don't know if I achieve it, but you'll have to let me know, I guess. But anyway, the bottom line was, this is a piece of heavyweight watercolor. It's, I think, 140 pounds. By Canson, and I just had a long piece that was pretty much scrap, and it was the absolute perfect size for inside cover, which is my answer to making those little end flaps more sturdy. So I wanted to obviously color it up and make it pretty, and I chose these two colors, and I just kind of had fun with this. I didn't really have a clear direction other than try to make it look like marble if I could, but at some point I start adding more water, and I realize, ooh, just let's get drippy. So I kind of have some fun with this. And there you see Dina Wakely paints at the right. And I just want to mention that I also use Dina's paints, the white paint in the cover, because I like the iridescence of the PBOs mixed with the flat paint of Dina Wakely's stuff. So it's awesome. I love mixing that together. That's why they're in the same box, my paint box there. But so just adding this green and the blue together to just kind of create this, basically it's just a mess, but it's a glorious mess because I just love making that. And at some point I realized, I think I want to introduce yellow. And I don't know if that was a good idea or not, but it works. I think the blue and the green weren't doing the mix that I thought they were going to. I thought that we were going to see a little bit more turquoisey, but we didn't. So I kind of introduced the yellow to make that happen a bit. And I kind of like how on the left-hand side it's really dark, concentrated color, and then it just sort of gets lighter and lighter, and then it's yellow. I like that. I think that accidentally is exactly what I wanted. and adding more water, letting it drip. And now at this point, I'm just taking the paintbrush and filling in anywhere there's white because I just didn't want any white. I want it all to be colored. So. Now, I've thoroughly enjoyed this project. It was an all-day event because there's a lot of dry time, but I enjoyed every second of it because I just didn't think too much. I just put it together. I knew I wanted to take a Jell-O box because it was the perfect size for those ID badges, and I knew that I wanted it to be bright and very cheerful. Summertime was really my goal, was to just capture summertime in my little book. And we're getting ready to go on a vacation, and it's an entire family vacation, and there's going to be lots of pictures to add in here, and I'm very excited about that. So to have a book all ready to go, it kind of inspires, some of the memories that we're going to capture. I can think about where they're going to go, and I think that's going to be fun. So now I've got a stamp set that is actually part of a kit that I sell on the website at craftshack.com, and I think we've got a few left. I think they're on sale now. And that stamp set is included with that kit. But it's a lot of fun to play with because it's kind of a grungy heart with swirls in it, and then there's like a grungy butterfly with swirls in that, and then this word dream and another phrase with possibilities on it, and I'm basically just taking my archival inks, and I think this one is green, a dark green, and a mixture of light and dark stamping here and there. And I think we use the butterfly next. Yeah, and this will be a deep purple, I think, is what I end up grabbing for this next part. I don't know if that was a good choice, but it works. It's bright. I didn't have like a blue of this that magnitude, you know. I wanted a brighter color, not, and the only archival blues that I have are very, very, very soft, so that would not have worked, but I think it worked out pretty good. Looks great to me. And I'd had thought about using the white on there and changed my mind. So see how perfect that size is? It was just a piece of scrap too. So I do pull out the trimmer. You're not going to see me trim it, but I trim it down so that that way it will accommodate the holes that I've made in the cover, so they won't be covered up. And yeah, I just measured to make sure that I'm going to do the right thing. And I cut them down, and now they're good to go. But then I realized I don't like those holes. So hubby ran to the store and bought me some of these. I don't even know what these things are called. They're like reinforcements. I know, I just showed you on the screen. You'd think I'd know. So it was like portable reinforcements, they call these, because this one is a portable package, but whatever. I just stuck those on and make sure that I use my bone folder to go over them really, really firmly so that they stick pretty good. They're kind of plasticky, so they should reinforce those holes pretty good. And then just using my Tombow, I glued on both inside covers, and it stuck down really well, and it made that little flap that's there on the left. It's actually on both sides, but there's just a little piece there. Now it is incredibly firm. Using the bone folder again to give it that perfect rub out. So I did that with both sides, and it's good to go. So that's the cover, and now we're ready to have some fun and decorate. Oh, and my fingers are such a mess. And you know why my fingers are a mess? I did 6 total projects during this time frame, and there's a couple other projects I did that were quite messy. So, all right, so here, these are some rub-ons from Kaiser Kraft that I had in my stash. I thought, well, these kind of look like leaves, those are leaves, let's see if we can do this. Ended up being not a great idea. The black was just too much of a stark contrast, it didn't really go. but I end up fixing it. Also had some issues because the getting the rub-ons to stick 100% because the I guess the paint wasn't totally dry. I don't know, I should have waited a day, but I didn't have a day. So, you know, when you're crafting, you're in the mood, you can't just wait for stuff to dry. That's not right. So you see me struggle trying to get this one little piece. It keeps wanting to come off because it's just not totally dry there. Eventually it all works out, but I did have some issues with the littler ones too, but I wanted you to see me struggle with this one so you can see that if it happens to you, you're not alone. It is irritating sometimes, but don't let it get the best of you. Just keep at it. So there, I've got them all on there, and you can kind of see that one of them was persnickety, and obviously the paint wasn't totally dry over there. But so now these are those neon colors that I found in my Walmart craft supply area, and I thought I'd give them a try. They look like they're fun and they're very transparent. So I think they'll be great on my jelly plate if there's any left for me to actually use on my jelly plate because I seem to want to use them on everything right now. So every single project I did yesterday included these bright pink, orange, and there's also a green, but I didn't use it on this project. And I'm just finger painting. I watch Cece do this all the time and I think, man, I want to finger paint. So I'm doing it. I'm having fun with my stuff. And I knew I wanted these little rosebuds and, you know, these little, I don't even know what they're called, but they look like little posies or something, I don't know. They look cute, and I'm very glad that I did these with my nasty, grubby fingers. My fingers are still stained. Yeah. It's the life of the crafter, anyway. And more letting it dry. But before I let it dry, I think, let's see, what happens next? I can't remember. Yeah, I did get it out. Okay, so this is another PBO paint of the Dyna line, and this is a green yellow, I think. Very iridescent, and I was at first just going to paint in the open spots on those leaves, and then liked it so much I decided to paint over the entire thing, and I'm glad I did because that black is just too black. It's okay to have an outline, but to have the solid leaf just made it look weird, disconnected even. Like it wasn't really a part of the image. So, and I'll just do that for all of the leaves you see there and add a couple extras to those ones that are floating by themselves. And the PBO paints are kind of translucent as well, so I do have to go over them a couple times to make sure that every place that I want covered up gets covered up. And I don't know if you can see that shimmer right there. You can. Just lovely iridescence. It's quite nice. That one on top looks kind of like a peach. Well. And then when you drop the paintbrush, you have to fix that. Right, we'll let that dry. So now that it's all dry, I come in with my Posca pens, and I love these Posca pens. They just make all of this so much more fun. I have not had a negative experience with the Posca pen yet, except I will tell you this, I use them so much I think my white one is running out. That's my only negative experience. They do run out eventually. How dare they? Good thing I know where to buy one, right? Anyway, so this was an experiment because I didn't know exactly what I wanted them to look like. And at first I thought I wanted them to be these perfect little posy, you know, half circle lines that would make it look like those first ones that you see there. And then I got over to the second bunch over there that I was just working on and followed some of the paint lines a little bit more, and I liked that better. And so I did that again up there with that one, and now I'm going to do it with this one, and just try to follow what I see the flower is doing based on the painting that I did, rather than trying to make it look perfect. That's, I guess, what I'm getting at. So the bottom line is, by this point, I'm like, you know what? I like that much better. Let's fix these. So I just kind of ruffled up the edges a little bit so that they were a little bit more loose. I think they turned out okay. It's a very nice thing to do. Just grab your pen and have at the paint like this. I think it's my newest favorite thing at the moment. And again, all I'm trying to do here is follow what I see in the paint. I see Sandra do this quite a bit. Sandra Artfully Made, and I'm just always enamored by what she puts out. So she can find faces in the paint that she draws, but I'm not there yet. I can only hope to aspire. So the black version now, I decided to go ahead and put some of that black back on the leaves, just because I think that it helps. It does help make everything pop a little bit, I think. I don't know. I just really like this whole thing. So, and then, of course, I do want to add, my latest thing is adding little dots here and there where I want there to be shadow or depth. And I think it's working out quite well. So in the center, around the edges of some of the leaves, or petals, I mean, so that way they look as though they are bending in and out. It seems to be working. You can't overdo it, too. I think I've said this before, but it's easy for me to overdo it, and that I have to be very careful of. There will be some close-up photos at the end that you can look at and see it a little bit better, of course. Well, and while I'm drawing, I would like to take a moment to thank you for watching. I hope that you've enjoyed these This and That Thursday videos. It is a lot of work for me to put these edited videos together, and you know, I don't mind the voiceover part of it. It's kind of cool, but it's not normal to me. This is very abnormal to me. But I do appreciate you watching. I appreciate you liking, you know, using the thumbs up lets me know that I should keep doing them. So if you are enjoying this and you haven't done so yet, please give it a thumbs up. That does let me know to keep going. And if you haven't done so, subscribe to our channel, because we are uploading a couple of videos every week, and that's really the only way to make sure that you don't miss one is to be a subscriber, and you'll want to turn on your notifications so that way you definitely get notified. So I decided I was going to take a picture. Oh, but I should probably turn off the video first. But so now we'll go ahead and put those ID badges in. I will suggest that you do what you see me doing there, and that is give them a good bending. They're quite stiff when they come to you in their packaging, and if you can just kind of separate them a little bit and bend them up a bit, they'll work a little bit better in the book for you. And this wasn't too difficult. Stick them in. And I just made sure that all the pockets were facing the same direction for ease of use. Close them up, and I have this cute little book that I can stick in my purse. I'm quite excited about it. The only thing that I might have done differently if I were, now that I've got one done, is maybe put some kind of a ribbon in that inside cover so that way I could tie it up. But that's the book. Thanks for watching. Have a crafty day, everybody. Bye-bye.